JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFT's daily market review for September the 22nd. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFT, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against all the other G10 currencies on Monday and during the major morning Tuesday. It gained the most versus NOK, NZD, AUD and SEG in that order, while it eked out the least gains versus the Japanese yen. The strengthening of the US dollar and the yen suggests that the financial community traded in a risk-off fashion. Indeed, turning our gaze to the equity world, we see that major EU and US indices were a sea of red, with the negative investor morale rolling into the Asian session today. Japanese markets were closed due to the autumn equinox holiday, while China's Shanghai Composite, Hong Kong's Hang Seng and South Korea's KOSPI are currently down 0.65, 0.87 and 2.57% respectively. The catalyst behind the deterioration in risk sentiment at the start of the week was the accelerating COVID-19 infections in Europe, which prompted some nations to proceed with renewed lockdown measures. Among those nations are Denmark, Greece and Spain, with Britain also considering a second round of restrictions as new cases rise by at least 6,000 per day. Adding to concerns was the death of the US Supreme Court of Justice and liberal icon Ruth Bader Ginsburg, which decreases the chances of Congress passing a new coronavirus aid bill to support the US economic recovery. Congress has for four weeks remained deadlocked over the size and shape of such a package, which with the chances of a breakthrough before the November 3rd election diminishing day by day. In contrast to last week's downturn, the slide in the beginning of this week was led by value stocks such as industrials, energy and financials, as opposed to technology stocks. That appears logical to us, as tech firms may be the least affected in case of a second round of lockdown measures around the globe. This is evident by the fact that Zoom video communications was among the main gainers on the Nasdaq 100 on the prospect that new restrictions may spur more use of the product. Airline, hotel and cruise companies also fell, with Europe's travel and leisure index marking its worst two-day drop since April. Up until last week, we had been holding the view that the slide in equities and risk-linked assets may stay limited and short-lived due to the extra loose monetary policy around the globe, as well as due to the positive headlines surrounding a potential coronavirus vaccine. However, the acceleration in coronavirus cases and consequently the fresh fears over a second lockdown, which could hamper the economic recovery, suggest that there is still ample room for further declines. Thus, we would now switch our view and we would see decent chances for the current retreat to continue for a while more. Among currency pairs, those which could pull back the most are those consisting of a risk-linked currency and a safe haven, the likes of Aussie dollar, Kiwi dollar, Aussie yen and Kiwi yen. Speaking about the Kiwi, tonight during the Asian morning Wednesday, the RBNZ will announce its monetary policy decision. At its latest gathering, the bank decided to keep its official cash rate unchanged at 0.25%, but expanded its large-scale asset purchase program adding that a package of additional monetary instruments must remain in active preparation, including a negative official cash rate and purchases of foreign assets. Since the previous meeting, the only top tier economic data we received was New Zealand's GDP for the second quarter, a quarter-over-quarter rate of which slid to -12.2% from -1.4%. That said, although a 12.2% quarter-over-quarter contraction is a severe one, it is still better than the bank's own forecast of -14.3% quarter-over-quarter. Therefore, combined with the fact that the bank has expanded its stimulus efforts just at the prior gathering, this is likely to keep officials' fingers off the easing button at this gathering. They may prefer to wait for more data before they reach safe conclusions as to whether more stimulus is needed or not. That said, we will dig into the statement for clues as to how likely such a move may be in the foreseeable future. Any hints that officials could push the easing button without hesitation in the months to come may bring the kiwi under additional selling interest. For the currency to rebound, the bank may have to signal that although further stimulus remains possible, it is not warranted at the moment, a scenario we see the least likely currently, especially with the coronavirus keeps spreading at a fast pace around the globe. Now, as for today's events, ahead of the RBNZ decision during the European morning today, we have another central bank deciding on monetary policy, and this is Sweden's Riksbank. At its latest gathering, this bank decided to extend its framework for its asset purchases from 300 billion SEK to 500 billion SEK up to the end of June 2021, while it announced that in September it will start purchasing corporate bonds. The board also decided to cut interest rates and extend maturities on lending to banks, despite keeping the repo rate unchanged at 0%. Latest inflation data showed that both the CPI and CPIF rates increased, even though by less than anticipated, but the core CPIF metric, which excludes the volatile items of energy, has slowed to 1.4% year-over-year from 1.5%. In any case, we believe that after acting at the previous gathering, a tick down in the core CPIF rate is unlikely to urge Riksbank policymakers to proceed with any policy changes at this meeting. Later in the day, the US existing home sales for August are coming out, and the forecast points to a slowdown to 2.4% month over month from 24.7%. The American Petroleum Institute weekly report on crude oil inventories is also coming out, but as it is always the case, no forecast is available. We also have five speakers on today's agenda: Fed Chair Jerome Powell, Bank of England Governor Andrew Bailey, ECB Chief Economist Philip Lane, ECB Executive Board Member Fabio Panetta, and Chicago Fed President Charles Evans. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm hosting every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.